Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to start. Lucky,
see who are our guests
Let's
tonight.
Have a look at our teaser.
Please welcome Melody Davidson.
Ladies and gentlemen, representing the Ukraine, Sergei Bubka. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Vitali Petrov.
We want to talk today about the big relation between athletes and coaches. What is a good coach? What is a good athlete? These are the big questions. And maybe the first question to the Olympic Games here. Sergei, how long will you stay? When did you arrive?
I arrive on 12, but I need to leave tomorrow. Oh, International Federation, because I'm vice president of International Federation. I have a meeting and next meeting. Pity, but it's great experience. It's fantastic.
Sergei was already our guest at the welcome session on stage with a lot of other athlete role models. Great to have you here. And I would say, let's start a little bit deeper in our today's topic, meet the coaches and of course also the successful athletes who are traveling together with the coaches from event to event. Let's start with the ladies and probably with Melody. An overall question at the start or for the start, did you have or do you still have a kind of coaching philosophy you followed throughout your whole coaching career?
Well, I think when I started, I didn't really have one. I grew up in a small town and I started coaching because as an athlete, I didn't feel like I had many opportunities and people around me didn't know what they were. So I started coaching to give people around me opportunities and let them know what was out there. And then as time went on, I really just, my philosophy was I just wanted to make a positive difference. Whether it was with the athlete themselves as a competitor or just themselves as a person in terms of how they developed and grew. And I think in the final stages here of my career, it's really been about developing the society, the future society. Like, the athletes we get are the next coaches and the next moms and dads, and just wanted to make sure they had as best experience as I could possibly create, and at the same time that they would be successful once they left the playing field. So I'd have to say those would be the three main points for me.
Mm-hmm. Jennifer, one question to you. Are there some crucial things in the relationship between athletes and coaches for you?
Yeah, I mean, I think a huge thing is trust, is trusting your coach and knowing that they have a plan and a vision for you. Certainly for us, every Olympic year was very challenging, and our coaches were demanding of us, but I think we also had to have full trust that they had this plan, and we had a tough training schedule, we had a very competitive schedule, we were traveling a lot, so there were days that you were exhausted. But in the end, I think you had to have that trust and know that they were doing what was best for you in the long run.
I read that your mother also participated in the Olympics 1964 here in Innsbruck.
Here in Innsbruck, yes. Yeah, and the same outdoor rink, I think.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
So big feelings for you.
It is, yes, absolutely. And I mean, I always admired my mother, and she went to two Olympics, and she went to her first Olympics when she was 16 years old. And yeah. I remember really looking up to that. And yeah, I mean, it just was encouraging to say, you know what, set your goals really high, because you never know what might be possible.
So your mother is into sports, your father is into sports.
Yes.
Is it possible for parents to be a coach?
I think it's possible. I think the thing for them is that they should be your biggest support network. And I've learned a tremendous amount from my dad in terms of your focus. He's done a lot of work in sports psychology. So in terms of the mental approach and having the right emotional preparation. And I've always said, and Mel knows that for me when I was playing, my saying was to play with a free mind and an unburdened heart. And that's when I felt like I was performing my best. And I think that's something that I learned from my parents, and they can be a very good support network for all of us.
Melody, Jennifer's brother played in NHL. We heard about her mother taking part in the Olympics. Is it hard to be a coach of an athlete with such a DNA?
No, it isn't actually. Our athletes come with a real balanced ego. They want to be better. They want to be good teammates, and they want to improve themselves, but they want to be successful as a team. And you know, Jen always brought that as a player. Always ready to compete and do whatever was necessary for us to be successful. And to be honest, I never ever thought about it.
Right. Sergei, Vitaly was your coach from the age of 10 on. You always called him the by far best coach when it comes down to techniques in pole vault. He understood or he understands technique way better than anybody else when it comes to pole vault. You were a good athlete in track and field, in sprint, in long jump. Was he the one who channeled your abilities and who recognized that you could be the new superstar in pole vault?
First of all, I'm really lucky with Vitaly because he, as I said before, he's a great coach. And for me, I'm here because of him. He was very clear, very smart. When I came to sport, he always take care about me, like about his son. He give me advice. He always try to develop all my skills. If it's connect to pole vault, we never had some weak areas. Mentally, physically, everything was developed very properly well. And also he always take in consideration to look to career when you come to real sport. Because here we have kids. This is for them the step to big sport. And Vitaly always said to me, we will never push, we will never force. If results come in naturally in 13, 14, 15, and the results is good, it's no question. But we need to come to sport to high level in age of 20, but not before. But we will come in 20, but we will come for long period. And this is important when you teach the young athletes. You need to take in consideration how they grow year by year, but the best result should be in the real big sport.
Vitaly, Sergei met you when he was 10 years old. Of course, he was talented, he had the skills a lot of other kids didn't have at his age. Do you think if he wouldn't have met you, or if you wouldn't have been his trainer, would it have been possible for him to get as good as he became?
Ну, может быть, не только это, а еще то, что мы здесь не сидели с Сергеем вместе, который, кроме спортивной большой карьеры, и делает большую карьеру политического спортивного деятеля. Я хочу сказать, что действительно, эта работа, это счастье такое, иметь такого человека, иметь с самого начала, как говорится, талант, с самого начала иметь хорошего тренера. Это как я себя хвалю, но так оно есть, наверное. И то, что, в общем-то, мы имели хорошие условия в свое время в нашей стране. Поэтому через 2 года, когда я его взял, 12 лет, я попытался узнать, а этому мальчику это спорт, зачем? Он пришел повеселиться, он пришел поиграть, он пришел отдать сюда все, что у него сегодня есть, все, что ему дала, говорится, генетика для достижения высших результатов в спорте. И через 2 года я сказал, у меня в руках есть великий спортсмен, я попробую сделать все, чтобы он добился этой цели. И он это сделал. И просто радость. Радость, потому что это был толчок мне к тренеру. Потому что после него уже у меня тоже прошли спортсмены очень высочайшего класса. И до сегодняшнего дня я работаю, заведую центром. Это не так просто уехать с одной стороны, поехать в другую, воспитать также великих спортсменов, чемпионов мира, призеров Олимпийских игр и продолжать, как говорится, свою карьеру любимого вида спорта.
I just want to add, find the beat of it. And honestly, I can say I will not be the same level. I could be very successful athlete because I love sport and I try to be the best, but I could not reach the same results. I really appreciate because he taught me to think, to understand, to be really clever, intelligent athlete, which go together with the coach who won goal in front of us. This is very important, go together. Coach and athlete live with the same dream, with the same passion to be successful.
What may be interesting at that point of time, Vital, you've been training with Ukraine athletes then. I read an interview, there was a point when you changed to train European athletes or Italian athletes. Is it the difference between training Sergei or a Ukraine or Russian athlete compared with the training of maybe, or for instance, Italians or otherwise?
Переход мой после работы с Сергеем в страну Италия наложил отпечаток не только на мой характер, но и на мое видение вообще тренера за рубежом. Ведь я должен был подчиниться этим, как говорится, законам другой страны. Но я знал, что мой закон тренерский, он должен существовать. Я должен быть требовательным, я должен делать свое дело хорошо, и я должен вести этого человека на высший пьедестал. В общем-то, как это и случилось. Джибилиска итальянцам. Я хочу сказать, что Сергей только что сказал, если бы не было Виталия, то, в общем-то, он бы не состоялся. Может быть, быть так. Но я хочу сказать, что такое талант. Вот я иногда даю ему упражнения. Я их, конечно, уже в голове проработал. Я уже дал себе направление, а как это сделать? И я прихожу и говорю, Сергей, у тебя плохой разбег, хотя ему было 17 лет. Он говорит, как? Мне все говорят, у меня хороший разбег, техника бега. Я говорю, Сергей, ты хочешь идти вперед? Меняй. И я меняю разбег. И когда он это делает, я вижу, что этот разбег даже увеличит мои, расширяет мои возможности ведения этого разбега. Он преподносит еще лучше, чем я представлял упражнение. И вот в этом и сила таланта. Когда тренер дает направление, а спортсмен, как актер, исполняет так, как никто уже исполнить не может. И на сегодня пока что его техника, это не только мои заслуги, вот именно его подражание, его понимание, понимание того, что ему передаю, вот это и дало ему преимущество над всеми спортсменами, при том с таким преимуществом, как он выигрывал, наверное, уже такого не будет.
Very, very interesting words. I hope everybody understood it. Thanks, by the way, to the simultaneous translator back there.
You
are doing an unbelievable job. Melody, you got the words from Vitaly, of course, as well. And you are a scout. Vitaly told us that he didn't expect that Sergei would somehow put his advices in real life and become even better than he expected it. Do you think it's possible for a coach or for a scout to see in the first second, oh my God, this is the new Jennifer Botterill, this is the new Sergei Bubka, or this guy will become as good as I think he will become if he does what I tell him, he or she, sorry?
Yeah, I think it's not so much about doing what we tell them, but providing them with an environment to succeed. And, you know, with team sports, you've got 20 athletes or 16, however many, and trying to get them all going in the right direction and get them all realizing their potential is a challenge. And I think, you know, that's why you have a coaching staff too, so that you can touch every athlete. But I think the biggest thing is to know yourself as a coach and how you impact your athletes, and then you have to know your athletes to know how to get the best out of each one of them.
Have there been a situation where you thought, oh my God, this will be the new Jennifer Botterill or the new Wayne Gretzky, and whatever, at the age of 16, 17, he totally like dropped out?
Yeah, for sure, because you have to have the passion as an athlete. You have to have the passion and the motivation to wanna succeed and wanna do what it takes, because it's not easy. And you do give up, there are a lot of challenges, you give up a lot of things to be successful. But in the end, I think it's really worth it. But if you don't have the passion, you're better off to find your own passion versus sticking with something you don't really want.
So we have two big coaches here on stage, Vitaly and Melody. One question to you, maybe. who is the better coach, or who are the better coaches, the men or the women? And maybe some seconds for you to think it over. Second question, what can women do better than men, and what's the difference?
Well, I'm not going to go down that road, to be honest. Not at all. I think that the opportunities in front of all of us, whether it's male or female, are tremendous in sport. And I mean, I have as much passion as this man beside me, for sure, and he has the same type of passion as I do. So I think it's more about doing what you love to do and working with great people.
Could you imagine to be the coach of a male ice hockey team?
For sure. I've coached men for about 15 years.
So, and what are the differences?
Some days there's huge differences. Some days, I think young men, you ask them to do something, they'll just go and do it. Young women want to know what's behind it, but they'll do it. They'll go and do it. You have to have more, a few more answers maybe, those types of things. And depending on the day, some days I'd rather coach men, some days I'd rather coach women. But again, for me, they're athletes. There is a different sort of communication line and a different way to work with men or with women, but either one is very rewarding, I found.
We have to be careful, as it is so interesting. I could ask questions for hours, but you are our guests tonight, and you should ask your questions, what you ever wanted to know from our guests up here on stage. Before, you have time, probably one answer more from Jennifer. And my question to Jennifer is, Jennifer, now we heard the standpoint of the coaches. From your point of view, you had for sure male coaches and female coaches. What was the biggest difference for you in the work together with them?
Difference. I think we've been fortunate to have really great coaches. And I mean, even for an example, in our Vancouver staff the recent Olympics, Mel was our head coach, but we had lots of male staff as well that was working with the team. And I think for us, selection for the staff, I think, was always finding the most qualified people. And I think it was a nice balance to have that, and people that were best in their role could provide to the team with the best possibility of being successful. So I think that was the approach that our organization took. And I think we just respected and appreciated people for the talent that they brought and all of the positive things that they brought to the team.
Do you think it was hard for the male coaches in your team to be with a big female boss, or with the big boss as a female coach, Melody, and they were somehow a little bit lower in the hierarchy?
I don't think people had an issue at all. I think people were honored and thrilled to be a part of the team, and that, you know, it was mentioned here too about having the same goal, the same vision, and I think that's what every single player felt. And every single staff member felt that, whether they were a head coach or they were the physician or the therapist or the equipment guy, whatever it was, I feel like every person had that same vision and that same passion, if you're male or female or whatever your role was.
From what I remember, this is called a super team then, that every single person is responsible for his somehow part, and it doesn't matter if it's a male or female. So the best persons on the most necessary positions.
Okay, now, so now guys, it's time for your questions. Please just raise your hand up in the air, and then our mic assist will come to you. Who of you?
Not everybody at the same time. Here we go, back there.
Please.
The first question.
The question's from Mel. Mel, you answered, in one of the answers you provided, you said that you worked with often a squad of 16 to 22 athletes. Can you talk to us a bit about the complexities that come with working with 16 to 22 different personalities and different athletes?
Yeah, sure. And I mean, I've coached individual sports too, in terms of swimming and some track and field. So I've worked the individual side of it. And I think as a coach of an individual athlete, you can really form a strong partnership there. And it just becomes about you and the athlete and where you want to go. With the larger teams, I mean, you still form good partnerships, but there's day to day, you got 20 people, and they're going in a different direction every day, and trying to get everybody down the same path is always a challenge. I think it's with teammates as well. you know, respecting each other's differences and realizing when somebody's having a good day or a bad day and working through that. It just makes the team dynamics more of a challenge. You know, to have a one-on-one when you coach one athlete is pretty easy. When you're coaching 20 and trying to touch base and communicate with them on a day-to-day basis is a huge challenge for sure.
Can I just add a credit to Mel? I think the sign of a great leader is understanding that you might need something different to motivate every different player. And I think a credit to Mel that she had that ability and understood that every person might need something a little bit different to perform their best in big situations. And I feel like she recognized that and took that to all the different athletes.
Okay, so as there are some Ukrainians here, maybe any questions of you? In the meanwhile, one question to Sergei. In how far it is important for an athlete to be his own coach? In how far have you been, as a person, your own coach? Are there some things, or did you just listen to Vitaly, what Vitaly says is gold, and I'm just doing that? Or have you been your own coach?
No, in our case, when I was young, we always studied different kilograms of different athletes, different pole vaulters, and he explained me what is good, what is wrong. And we select all the best part from every best athlete, and we create the ideal pole vaulter, which never exists. This was our goal. And of course, in this case, I always trust my coach. I completely agree. You must trust your coach. You must follow what he's telling you, because he shared the knowledge. He put all his experience to you, and you should implement. Of course, I agree with Vitaly when he mentioned you must be also very talented, and one of the most important talents, you must execute what your coach requests, what your coach asks. This is very important, and you must match together with coach. He has vision, and you should implement exactly what he wants to see.
Sergei, you worked together with Vitaly for 16 years?
Yes.
So this was from 73, 74 to 90. Why did you split up at a certain point?
Now, of course, we achieve everything, and we start. For me, it was dream to become Olympic champion, to become world champion. And we did with Vitaly 20 world records together. We won Olympic Games, a few championships, indoor, outdoor. We won everything. And for Vitaly was also the dream and goal from the beginners to Olympic champion. And we achieved that. And of course, I think in this case, each of us maybe start to think about something, new experiences, new goals. Vitaly was invited to move to Italy, in our country, a lot of changes. He went to Italy, he started to work with Gibilisco. In 10 years, he brought him, and Gibilisco became a world champion. He took him almost from childhood. This is, I think, it's the experience which he wants, and I want to continue.
I see. So guys, maybe any more questions of you, just raise your hand. And yes. I knew that you want to know something. Thank you.
Hey, a question to Melody and Jennifer. What's the strangest exercise that you guys have done in order to build team spirit? And what's the strangest exercise you guys have done, but what's the strangest exercise you've ever heard of an ice hockey team doing, or any team doing, in order to build team spirit?
And did it help?
Yeah, well, yes.
I'm in my mind debating now between camping trips and curling tournaments. I feel like we've done some different things. The camping trips were part of a training camp that we did for about 4 weeks, and then it was at the end of it, we were totally exhausted. I mean, people are at their breaking points, but we were camping, and we were in these small little cabins with people, so that was certainly pushing your limits, but ended up being, I think, one of the moments we talked about most at the end of the Olympic year. But another one that was really good for the team atmosphere, we did a curling tournament, and I mean, it's popular in Canada, but being a hockey player, not many of us had ever curled before in our lives. But it ended up being just something totally different that we had done. And again, I think it was just really great for the camaraderie of the group. Do you have any others?
No, I think, though, the biggest mistake I ever made on one of the camping trips was scheduling a 50-kilometer bike ride to a place that had no cell phone, internet, or TV. And Stanley Cup Game 7 was that night. Thank goodness the park manager had a TV about the size of a computer screen, and the girls, as soon as they got off their bikes, they were in that poor guy's house. And to this day, I'm still not sure he had the Olympic team in his house, but we got to watch this Game 7 of the Stanley Cup Final, but that's the biggest screw-up I ever made when doing a team builder. But no, I think camping, curling, anything that takes an athlete outside of their comfort zone and you can still work mentally or physically is always good to prepare yourself for competition.
Vitaly, yeah. In 92, you weren't the coach of Sergei anymore, and during these Olympic Games in Barcelona, not a lot came together for Sergei. What did you think in these moments in Barcelona, or did you try to help Sergei probably after his third or fourth failed attempt?
Если бы я мог, конечно, попытался бы, но в этот момент, наверное, у Сергея было что-то свое внутреннее. Я вспомнил, как 15 лет, когда Сергей имел 15 лет, у нас был чемпионат страны, и вот там он тоже был, как говорится, на голову сильнее всех спортсменов. И вот он как-то странно вел себя. Я купил ему этот журнал развлекательный «Крокодил», тогда у нас был такой модный. И так, Сережа, и так. Попробовал даже шлепнуть по лицу, но вижу, что человек где-то в другом мире находится. И вот немножко вот что-то из этого у меня так... Я когда пришел, сел на стадионе, сидели возле меня специалисты, я говорю, ребята, что-то мне не нравится сегодня. Не нравится, потому что этот человек напомнил мне еще раз то 12-13 лет назад случай. И тогда я спросил Сергея, когда он еще был молодой, Сережа, а что же случилось? А ты знаешь, я представил, как я вернусь домой с медалью чемпиона страны и покажу и дома, и своим ребятам. И, конечно, это волновало. Его ответственность перед всеми настолько велика, что он не мог сдержать вот этих эмоций, которую мы называем психологической, там чего-то там слабость. Нет, это не слабость. Это действительно ответственность перед своей работой. Ответственность, за которую он знал, он готов уже это сделать, но не сделал. Я думаю, что-нибудь, это он сам скажет, что-то случилось и здесь, когда распалась страна, стала новая республика Украина, Россия. И он выступает здесь, он представляет совершенно новую республику. И вот здесь ему нужна была медаль, может быть. Он хотел этого. Он опять хотел, чтобы страна по-новому поняла, что мы не умерли, что мы опять пойдем развиваться новым путем, своим, который, в общем-то, он уже имел в виду в своей будущей карьере. И поэтому, я думаю, вот эта ответственность наложила немножко на него вот этот стресс, который разбил основные связи между прыжком и ритмом. Поэтому ругать нельзя здесь никого. Здесь это жизнь. И каждый человек из таких ситуаций выходит еще сильнее. И он после 92 года показывал такие результаты, что мир до сих пор восхищается этими прыжками, которые вы видели, в общем-то, перед началом вашего конгресса.
Sergei, retrospective now viewed on this topic. Your son is an unbelievable good tennis player. He is ranked at the moment 152 in the single ATP ranking. If, for example, your son would win the French Open next year and will get back to Paris in 2014, or he would win the Olympic title in London next year and get back to Rio de Janeiro 2016 and feeling the same pressure as you did after your victory in Seoul in 88, what would be your advice or retrospective? What was your biggest mistake in 92? And what would you advise your son to probably avoid to defend his title?
No, I think it's very important to be yourself, to be very confident, because it's atmosphere if you go to Olympic Games or you go to World Championships. Atmosphere is creates unbelievable stress. You need to keep yourself as much as possible on the ground. You need to focus, compete when you go to the field of competition, not compete in the hotel or in the village, because you're thinking about the final day. You work so many years, your goal is very close. In this moment, mentally, you don't need to compete before you went to the stadium. This is very important because you can burn yourself too much. It's better to read some book. You need to move your head out of the competition, but only compete when you're in place of competition. This is very important. And of course, for any sportsman and also for my son, he should work hard. He needs to improve himself day by day if he wants to achieve his goal, if he wants to be the number one. You must remember, you're born like everyone. No one born to be the champion. You build your career and you become the champion. This way for every one of you. I start, I was small, I fight, it was not easy, but I'm happy and proud to achieve such a goal. And of course, I wish all of you, you have incredible talent, you have fantastic passion, you have beautiful coaches around you, everyone dreaming to support you. But in the end, you need to face the difficulties, you need to overcome this and to become the best.
Yeah, clapping is allowed. We will continue immediately with you. Just one second. Melody, at such an extreme situation like Sergei faced it in 92, he was the top of the tops. He was the world's best pole vaulter already, with world records, achieved everything. What can a coach do in such a situation? Or is a coach then more a friend than a coach?
I think you're more a friend. In my case, I just wouldn't play that player. I'd play the ones that were ready to go. But you do everything you can leading up to that event to make sure that your players have experienced, your athletes have experienced as much as possible. So when they get to that moment, they're ready to move on. But I think the point about removing yourself from the competition until you get to the competition is so important, because you can become obsessed with it as a coach or as an athlete. And one, you miss out on the enjoyment of everything. And two, you've already beat yourself before you even get to the event. So, you know, being able to separate yourself and enjoy moments that are outside the sport are so important.
Okay, so now we can continue with your question, please.
Шала, это какое у вас было отвлечение от этого? И насчет стрессов, были они у вас и как вы их избегали?
Now, I'm human being. I am a very sensitive person, and I felt very strong pressure the all the time, particularly when you prepare for Olympic Games. I missed my first Olympic Games in 1984. When I was 20, I was the best. It was one of the best my year. I set up 7 world records that year, but I missed because of boycott. The Soviet government decided this is dangerous to compete in Los Angeles Games. It's very painful for me today. But when I came to 88 Olympic Games, and I had such a stress and such a pressure, because I dreamed to win Olympic Games. And when I came to the final, I couldn't believe my brain work as usual. I understand everything. But it's only one competition in my life when my body didn't listen to me. I understand everything, but I couldn't control my body. And only for last attempt. And also in the beginning, you saw that incredible scream, it's incredible excitement. This was my Olympic title when I become Olympic champion. This was very tough moment. Tough for me because I'm in the field of competition, I can manage something. But I know how it was difficult for Vitaly to resist. He sees something is going wrong. If I didn't clear this result 5.90 meters, I'm out of the podium. I could miss my second Olympic title. Of course, it's tough and very stressful. And always I try to manage. And when I said
try to not to think before so much, because atmosphere when you come into the competition, they lift your emotions. In this case, you can handle your emotions. In 92, 4 years later, after so many years experience, after so many victories, that time already I won everything. But again, I did mistake. For me, it was dream to set up world record in Olympic Games. Because it was a lot of talk, Sergey Bubka jump in 1 day competition, but he never did world record and world championships. He will never did in Olympic Games. And I wish and I dream to prove it, that I can do my best results. I could do world record in Olympic Games. And this has hurt me so much because I focused so much for the record, and of course I missed first heights. You need to do all the time one thing in the time. When you, in my case, when I did my first height, I can focus for the next one. When I won the competition, I can focus for world record. But I focused too much for world record, and it hurt me, and I missed the Olympic Games.
You've got another question?
I just wonder if you could speak to what keeps you passionate and what advice you would give to aspiring coaches to keep passionate and stay passionate about what they're doing.
Well, I think, you know, I love the sport, obviously, and I love working with the young athletes and seeing them, as I said at the very outset, that you can have an impact on society and what's going to happen next. So I think those were real important. I think one of the biggest things I realized probably about 10 years ago was the importance of who you surround yourself with in terms of understanding what you're doing and what you're going through. I was the oldest in my family, and I didn't have any babies and no grandkids for my mom and dad. And there was a lot of pressure from them early on, and then once they understood and my friends started to understand and I eliminated people that were energy takers, it really helped me enjoy it. And then they started to come along for the ride, and it became more about where was I going to go next so they could plan their next holiday and the fun they would have. And that really helped me out because I didn't have to feel guilty about making time for people, or, you know, they made time for me. So, but I mean, that's important because of those relationships, but mostly just the love of the game and the difference I really believe that you can make in people's lives if you do it to the best of your ability.
We were talking how to keep the passion. Maybe one question for Vitaly. You've developed some kinds of the technique of pole vault, how it is actually. How important is it for a coach to be a pioneer?
Я не знаю, какой я вклад внес, какой еще несу вклад. Но я считаю, что прыжок шестом – это тот вид, где я, ну, как говорится, чувствую себя как рыба в воде. Потому что этот вид знаю хорошо, знаю стратегию, я знаю стратегию мира, тренеров, что хотят спортсмены. И мне легко, в общем-то. До сегодняшнего дня, в общем-то, я имею 29 медалей европейского, мирового, олимпийского достоинства, как один тренер в одном дисциплине. Это не так уж мало. И можно здесь говорить с уверенностью, что за свои 47 лет работы, стажа, я действительно немножко осознал, что это такое. Но совершенствованию нет предела. Нужно идти дальше. И нужно идти так, чтобы ты не отстал от этой молодежи. Потому что сегодня говорят, вот молодые, совсем другие, они не хотят работать. Это тренеры, которые не хотят сами работать. Нужно идти к молодым, нужно быть с ними, нужно идти вперед и жить их жизнью, поддерживать и помогать им идти дальше вперед. Это мое кредо.
Your world record, 6 meters 14, is valid since 94. He said there is so much possible. Vitaly, your coach, said there is still so much possible, so much to do. He loves the sport and he still thinks he can develop the sport. Why? The last 18 years, nobody came behind you to break your world record in a world which is getting higher, faster, better, almost every day. And then in such a complex sport as pole vault, the probably most complex sport in the whole world, nobody came during the last 18 years to break your world record.
No, this is more professional, maybe more technical question, but I can say the main key issue, it's technical skills. Because what the Vitaly, with his vision, he was pioneer. For that, I execute what he taught me. And this level, I consider 6'14 outdoor, 6'15 indoor. This is my two best results, outdoor and indoor. It, in my understanding, it should be 6'30, 6'40. 6'30, 6'40, but the main point for coaches, they should always focus to your opponent. You should communicate with the coaches and you need to learn from them as much as possible. To be better tomorrow, not to stay. If you just stop, you are losing, you lost. But you need to look always what should be improved. I think that the main key, it's technical skills. I can understand I was professional. I really dedicated, I'm happy because it's for me the sport is everything what I have. I really love sport and of course you need to improve yourself day by day. You need to look what is new, what are the coaches doing. If you have some clinics or you have some seminar for coaches, you need to go and study and try to understand what is the future. For me, pole vault coaches today, I think, difficult to know, of course, better to ask them, but they miss main key point of technique of pole vault. This is the only the question why the athletes today, it's not jumping better. They have everything, but technique must be better.
Yeah, of course, we have enough time. Any other questions from your side? Any more questions?
In the first row.
First row.
I have a question for Melody about team selection. When you're picking a team, whether it's Team Canada or any other team, just wondering what you prioritize. So do you look at team dynamics as a priority where you're willing to release a very talented player knowing that they could negatively affect your team chemistry? Or is it a question where you'll put the best players in the team and hope that they gel and become a team together?
No, I think definitely team chemistry is huge, but you know, over time, you like to build that. You like to take an athlete that maybe doesn't have a good attitude or perceived bad character or whatever, and work with them and find out why that's there and how you can change that. So, I mean, I would exhaust all avenues on that to begin with. But, I mean, team selection is a roundabout thing. They've got to be good teammates. They've got to bring a skill. They've got to bring something to the table for the team to succeed. But it all comes down to one, would I pick someone that's going to cause a lot of trouble in the room just because they're skilled? No, I wouldn't. I think that you can always fill in those holes on a team, especially if you get pick all the right people. But I would certainly exhaust all avenues of working with that person to see if you can change your behavior or get them to understand, you know, what's important here for the group.
Vitaly, I have one more question for you. Before the USSR collapsed, 7 out of the top 9 pole vaulters were out of the Soviet team. So this is an individual sport. How do you think, or how important is it for an individual sport to have a strong core training group?
Наша методика, конечно, была одна из наилучших в мире, потому что она начала развитие свое где-то в 1936 году и довольно-таки успешно и прогрессивно развивалась силами Азолина, Дьячкова, Раевского, Ягодина и многих других тренеров и достигла, в общем-то, хорошего основания. Но надо было что-то толкнуть в эту систему. В этой системе не хватало той перспективы, которая, в общем-то, должна наметиться была. Вот как-то прыгал Казакевич, польский спортсмен, 5.81 на Олимпиаде. А я говорю, Сергей, ну что мы будем с ними соревноваться? Ну что, бунт опять, да, сантиметр вперед, сантиметр назад. А что нужно сделать? Я говорю, поднять хват надо. Как хват? Мне и так высокий, как и во всех ведущих от этого мира, 4.83. Я говорю, знаешь что, давай так, 5 метров надо держаться. А может быть, потом мы выше возьмемся. И тогда мы как-то их опередим. Если нет, это игра будет просто. Сегодня ты, завтра я. И вот он за два дня поднимает с 83, это очень высокая прибавка, до 5 метров хват. И потом в своей карьере это поднимает до 5,18, опять же самый высокий хват в мире. И потом он на тренировке готов на хвате 5,25. То есть он был готов не на тот результат 6,15, он был готов на результат 30-40, как он сказал. Но да, ему нужно было это последовательность, шаг за шагом. Как я ему говорил, Сережа, не спеши делать слишком много прыгать, не надо торопиться. Увековечь себя в этом спорте. Чем чаще ты будешь делать мировые рекорды, тем тебя будет мир помнить дольше. И сегодня Бубку помнит, где бы то ни было, в столовой, на улице, в трамвае, Бубка. Потому что действительно 35 мировых рекордов, столько побед, это мог сделать только великий человек.
Sergey, these 35 world records, how much is it important for you to set the world records, or was it more important for you to just doing sports? How do you see the situation now? How important are these records now for you?
Basically, this is past. This is incredible time, it's incredible an experience. I was very happy. My family also happy, but millions of people all over the world, they celebrate together. They give me motivation to set up new records. In certain stage when I began, I focus, of course, and I try to prove for myself. But in some moment, I realize I prove for myself. And when I came to the stadium, when I see the full stadium, I compete for them. They give me motivation. For me, it was not any more interesting. I tried to do my best and make happy so many people and encourage so many kids to come to sport. Because this sport experience, it gives great opportunities in the life. And of course, it's this 35 records, it's important for me. Because it's great time, but you still need to go for new goal, for new challenges. Because you should never stop. Never stop, try to go forward, put new goals, achieve new goal, and go for the next one. Because the life always give experience. And you need to use this experience for better performance. Because everything depends on you. It's no one can change your life, you can change your life. And if you want to be the champion, you will be the champion. But put energy, put hard work, listen your coaches, and you will achieve your goal.
Jennifer.
Oh, it's that easy.
Yeah. Luki and me and Jennifer are almost the same age, I would say. Jennifer, when you hear the statements from our three experienced, wise coaches, sportsmen, is it inspiration for you still? Even you won already, like all these Olympic medals. Is this inspiration? Are you feeling as you would be at the Youth Olympic Games as a competitor at the moment that you are talking with three athlete role models?
Oh, I think so. I feel like, how can you not be inspired with the people up on this stage? And I think you take that to whatever role that you have and whatever you're currently involved with. And when Sergey was talking about the experience of sharing it with people, and that really struck a chord with me. And certainly having been in a team sport, I always try to bring out the best in the people around me. That was something that I always tried to take pride in, that whether it was in the locker room or it was on the ice competing, that I wanted to make sure that I made my teammates better, the ones that were around me. And then especially when I think about my favorite moments in sport or what was inspiring, it was sharing those moments. And for us, when we competed in Vancouver in Canada, you know, to feel the support of the country in the stadium, you know, what you dreamed about as a kid, and to have that moment and share it with people. And to this day, it's rewarding when you meet people across the world and they tell you, or they remember that Olympic moment, or they remember that World Championship moment. Ultimately, you know, that is what's the most rewarding, is that you get to share that experience with people. And it was just, the one story I often tell, it was just after I got back from Vancouver, and I went to my hometown where I grew up, and this mother came and introduced herself, and she said, my 6-year-old daughter and I, she said, we watched your gold medal game on TV, And she said, oh, we stood up in our living room. She said, we sang the anthem with you guys. We had tears in our eyes. And I told her, I said, well, thank you. That's what makes it so meaningful. And she said the day after the gold medal game, her six-year-old daughter and her went to the outdoor rink. And as soon as this six-year-old girl, what she did, she tied up her skates and she hit the ice. And as soon as she went on the ice, all she started doing was throwing up her gloves and her stick in the air repeatedly. And her mom's laughing, what are you doing? And this six-year-old girl, she turns, she looks up at her mom, and she said, I'm just practicing. She said, I'm just practicing my celebration. But for us, I think you find motivation where you have the chance to impact the people around you and share those
practicing
experiences.
For the Olympic title,
yes,
and
yes,
the celebrations, that's great. Melody, my last question, Luki, then you can ask it. I think you
the
all
most
are
important
guests as well.
Is that
yeah,
you are questioning
you are asking.
Today.
So
you
think
are
about
asking
a couple of last questions.
Yeah.
I have one more question to Melody. Sergei told us even when he quit his active career, he always set himself new targets, new goals. Businessman, IAAF, vice president, athletes commission, IOC, and so on and so on. Do you think it's in the DNA of an Olympic gold medalist, of an absolute superstar, the best of the best in a sport that also after his active career, that he keeps on pushing, also in private life, in business life, or no matter what he is doing, playing tennis with his son or whatever, he always wants to be the best. Is this in the DNA of a superstar?
Yeah, I think so. I think when all of us change careers or we move from one part of our lives to another, it's all about what's going to motivate us next and where can we make a difference and how can we change things. And I think that comes as an athlete. You're always driven, you're always motivated to be better, to make a difference, whatever it might be. And when you step away from competing or coaching, whatever it might be, I don't think that ever dies inside of you, and you just take on new challenges and go at it with the same type of passion as you had when you competed.
Okay, so as we mentioned, it's not important that we are asking you. Your questions are important, ladies and gentlemen. So we have some more minutes left. I think if you have got questions left, please raise your hand.
Скажите, пожалуйста, всегда, когда растет чемпион, вот из детского возраста, ему нужна команда, нужно окружение, даже если это индивидуальный вид спорта. Как вы, как тренер, смогли удержать вот вокруг вот эту команду, которая позволила, или ну, в каком возрасте, вот до какого возраста Сергей тренировался со своими одногруппниками, одногодками, или ну, потом вот сразу попал во взрослый спорт. Как вы, как тренер, какие вы придумали способы, как вот удержать как можно дольше ребят, и чтобы у них тоже росли результаты, потому что все равно понятно из группы, кто сильнейший, да, и всегда возникает конкуренция, может где-то зависть, дети особенно чувствительны к этому. Вот как вы с этим справлялись?
Это действительно вопрос сложный, особенно когда в руках у тебя талант, когда это все какие-то спорт индивидуальный, не командный. Здесь нужно так варьировать этими делами, что нужно, что опасно даже что-то передержать, как говорится, как вот что-то готовишь на кухне, знаете, и передержал. Вроде все правильно, продукты, это, но борщ или суп или что-то там, не получилось блюдо. И поэтому, когда я взял его, ему было 10 лет, были те же мальчики, 10-12 лет. Но буквально через год он их всех перегнал. Я эту всю группу разогнал, набрал постарше, потому что у меня была другая, более старшая группа, 15 лет. И вот тогда, когда он и вторую группу уже начал обгонять, я его перевел к старшим. И вот здесь у меня уже сложился климат. Климат такой, что или ты идешь на высший результат, который ты можешь показать в своей жизни, или ты просто должен уйти с этой группы. Это не было, как говорится, выгнать спортсмена. Нет, спортсмена не выгонял никогда в жизни. Но это была та группа, тот климат, в который вливались не только те ребята, которых я тренировал, но уже были другие, с других городов, с других республик, с других стран. И поэтому климат этот, который, в общем-то, и строился на воспитании великого спортсмена и воспитывал высокие результаты. Поэтому нужно варьировать, нужно искать. Но талант, он всегда талант, и на него нужно работать. Работать максимум, работать сердцем, самоотдачей. Это не только спортсмен, это тренер. Он тоже, Сергей, представлял, что я имею семью, что я имею там трех дочерей, что я имею то и то, Но я был их отец. Я был спортивный отец для них. И даже, будем так между говорить, свадьбу он сыграл, свадьбу, да, когда мне мой день рождения, первого сына назвал в честь меня. То есть я заслужил это право быть в его семье. То есть я ему дал столько, сколько смог отдать, а он отдал все для развития нашего прекрасного вида спорта прыжков шестом.
Just want to add, it's like the Vitaly, it's always what he already mentioned. I just want a little bit clarification. When I become the best in the group, he always put me to the stronger group. When I reach the best position, to next one, because he never want that I start to be, I don't know, maybe snobbish or the champion on this level. He always taught me to climb. And I think for young coaches, it's very important climate and environment in the group. He always bring to the group someone who runs sprint very well. Someone is do weightlifting, someone is gymnastic. He always put the group where I need to climb, where we need to fight to be the best. Because to be the best too early, it's very dangerous. You need to mature, you need to understand, you need to able to handle when you are the leader and the best. And the Vitaly in this case, he was so good and very smart. Of course, I realized that now, later when I finish, but that time he planned and built the career step by step, but with clear vision, with clear understanding psychologically of the young athlete, atmosphere in the team, and he played really, really, really great with us. He lead and he give us passion, and we try to bring this passion to his expectation.